All right, so I'm Bob Trug, and I'd like to welcome all of you to this wonderful occasion where we're going to celebrate Dan Brock's career. And I'm very grateful for you for coming, and also for our speakers who all have intersected with Dan's life in one way or another. And we're going to cover many areas in which Dan has been involved, and probably some new frontiers as well. The format that we chose was to have sort of four sections to the day, each one with a keynote speaker followed by a commentator and then plenty of time for discussion. So the pace of the day should be fairly relaxed, and we should have lots of opportunity to explore these issues. Our first session is going to feature Professor Alex Capron, and Dan Wikler will be the moderator. Topic's going to be four decades of changing taboos in death and dying. And I'm going to cite mostly from the program here about Professor Capron's credentials. Must say, as a graduate of UCLA, it's very difficult for me to speak about somebody from hated rival USC, but I'm going to do my best not to choke here. So, Alex, unbelievable credentials here. Rank of university professor at USC, the Scott H. Bice Chair in Healthcare Law, Politics, and Ethics at the Gould School of Law, where he teaches public health. He really crosses the university in so many ways. He's professor of law and medicine at the Keck School of Medicine. He serves as director of three university-wide activities, the Pacific Center for Health Policy and Ethics, the Health System Improvement Collaborative, and the Research Ethics Institute of the Southern California Clinical and Translational Science Institute, also having taught at Georgetown and Yale as well. And I'll also just introduce Dan at the same time so that we can flow right into the commentary afterwards. Dan Wikler is the Mary B. Saltonstall Professor of Ethics and Population Health in the Department of Global Health and Population at the Harvard School of Public Health. And many interesting aspects of his life, only some of which are mentioned here. Served previously as the first staff ethicist for the World Health Organization in Geneva, a philosopher who's touched on almost every aspect of bioethics, most recently focusing primarily on population-level ethics, co-edited the volume Inequalities in Health, Concepts, Measures, and Ethics. So why don't we go ahead and Alex, you're here. And
thank you, Bob, and good morning. Ein Festschrift ist nur nicht ein Fest, sondern auch ein Schreiben. Und da ich dieses Stück geschrieben habe, Sie gehen zu müssen, ihm zu anhören. So that basically says that since I've written this paper, I am not going to extemporize. I actually am going to read from it. On Wednesday, November 22nd, 1978, the light of dawn still hadn't broken through the soggy darkness in Providence, Rhode Island, when a 40-year-old one-time stockbroker awoke in his home, got up, looked out the window, and decided to dress warmly against the icy rain. He went downstairs where his wife already had a pot of coffee brewing, fixed himself a bowl of cereal, and spent a little while reading the stories in the New York Times, which reported that the yield on two-year treasury notes had hit its highest level since these securities were first offered in 1974. The paper also conveyed the weird details emerging about the massacre that had occurred in Jonestown and discussed the 15th anniversary of President Kennedy's assassination. Bundled up in his overcoat, he went off to his office at Brown University, where he was a tenured associate professor of philosophy, best known for his articles about utilitarianism and morality. Some 415 miles away in McLean, Virginia, the senior senator from Massachusetts was relaxing with his family, glad that the Democrats, who had experienced smaller losses than expected in both the House and Senate elections 3 weeks before, still controlled both houses by substantial margins. He was pleased, too, that on November 9, 1978, President Carter had signed into law the senator's most recent health care statute, Public Law 95-622, which, among other things, extended community mental health centers, revised the programs of assistance for medical libraries, augmented the National Research Service Awards, enlarged NIH's cardiac and cancer research programs, and created the President's Commission for the Study of Ethical Problems in Medicine and Biomedical and Behavioral Research. But neither that statute nor even that commission was on the mind of anyone at Brown, at least not in the philosophy department, on that cold fall day. Yet, by the time 4 years later that Professor Stephen Toulmin famously opined that medicine had saved the life of ethics by bringing into its discourses the urgent and consequential issues of life and death, a similar transformation had already been wrought in the life of that stockbroker turned philosopher. The transformation began in the fall of 1980 when he was asked to join a panel of scholars being assembled by Professor Daniel Wikler, who was serving as the first staff philosopher at the Presidential Commission created in that 1978 statute. Based on his service in that panel, the Brown philosopher was asked to take a leave from his university, where he'd just been promoted to full professor, and come to Washington on a full-time basis for a year as Professor Wikler's successor. So began the career in bioethics of one of the most influential and widely respected figures in our field. Over the succeeding decades, the name Dan Brock has become synonymous with some of the deepest, most carefully crafted, and most insightful philosophical thinking about the issues arising in human genetics, in research with human subjects, and in dying and the care at the end of life. I focus in this essay on the latter topic, one to which Professor Brock has made particularly significant contributions. And I'll be speaking principally of the contributions when he was working for that commission, but also as he's elaborated it in many articles and several books. I begin by reminding us how recently we've moved beyond doubting the medical and legal acceptability of not doing everything possible to sustain life, a movement very much connected with Dan's role at the President's Commission and his subsequent scholarship. I will then re-examine the current default position regarding the care at the end of life, which seems settled in medical ethics, but remains a matter both of heated political debate and, I believe, of unresolved conceptual problems. And I will conclude by connecting the topic of end-of-life care to another enormously important issue, one to which Professor Brock has also contributed, as we will hear later, and which may be the most contentious in healthcare in the coming decade, namely how and by whom decisions should be made to ration care that is judged insufficiently beneficial. For all the progress that has been made, we're still dealing with a number of taboos. Just as openly discussing death and dying, much less pulling the plug, was unthinkable in many circles in the 1970s, four decades later, the use of cost-effectiveness analysis regarding the end of life generates dire warnings of death panels. When Congress created the President's Commission in 1978, it mandated that it study half a dozen topics, ranging from genetic counseling and screening to the protection of human subjects and research. It also gave the commissioners the authority to add to the topics under study. Early in 1981, the commissioners decided to produce a study on foregoing life-sustaining treatment as a natural outgrowth of its mandated studies on informed consent, the definition of death, and access to health care, and because the topic involved, quote, some of the most important and troubling ethical and legal questions in modern medicine. As it turned out, all the commission's reports had substantial effects in terms of governmental policies and public and academic discourse, but none more so than deciding to forgo life-sustaining treatment. It is not as though the topic was unheard of when the commission took it up. Quite the contrary, as the report acknowledged in its opening paragraph. Americans seem to be increasingly concerned with decisions about death and dying. Why is a subject once thought taboo, now so frequently aired by the popular media, debated in academic forums and professional societies, and litigated in well-publicized court cases? The commission answered its own question by pointing to several factors. During the preceding three decades, dying had moved from the home to institutions such as hospitals and long-term care facilities. And in such settings, when disputes arose about whether to use or forego medicine's ever-growing armamentarium of drugs and machines to stave off death, their resolution tended not to be private matters, but ones that required formal procedures and rules. Embedded in that description are two further factors: that death had increasingly become a matter of deliberate decision, since medical interventions were able to retard and even to reverse many conditions that until recently were regarded as fatal, and further, that neither physicians nor the lay public had a clear compass to guide those decisions under a wide range of circumstances. This uncertainty was especially pronounced when physicians and other people were deciding for others, that is, making decisions about patients whose conditions or treatment rendered them unable to direct the course of their own treatment. Such cases were occurring with greater frequency because medical treatment was rescuing an increasing number of patients who would previously have died of brain injuries and the like, but who were instead left in a newly defined status of the persistently vegetative. These factors led the commission to pose another set of questions, ones to which it offered 255 pages of answers. May a patient's withdrawal from treatment ever be forbidden? Should physicians acquiesce in patients' wishes regarding therapy? Should they offer patients the option to forego life-sustaining therapy? Does it make any difference if the treatment has already been started or involves mechanical systems of life support or is very costly? These questions may now seem puzzling or quaint, but at the time, they were very real and often seemingly intractable. Beginning in the late 1960s, some critics of contemporary healthcare practices had argued for the right to die with dignity. Of course, no one was arguing for treating patients harshly or disrespectfully, yet the invasive and burdensome measures used, which were often offered as the only hope of sustaining life and reversing potentially fatal conditions, sometimes left that impression. Physicians may have been as upset with that state of affairs as patients and family, but frequently they seemed simply unwilling or unable to deal with it. Any discussion was taboo, made so by a sense of fear, disappointment, or helplessness, or the conviction that, difficult as it was, keeping everything running was morally compulsory. We need to have that world clearly in mind because I expect that you will find in the examples that I've selected concepts that seem so familiar, so obvious, that it is hard to believe that they were in the least controversial, much less radical. Yet it seems to me remarkable how much thinking about end-of-life treatment has changed in the past three decades, indeed, how rapidly that change occurred beginning in the early 1980s. We are used to rapid changes in healthcare and biomedical research. Across the past half century in many fields, bioethical ideas have been reconsidered, driven by these dramatic developments in research. When the commission was chartered, human genome mapping didn't exist, and patients weren't given a GWAS. There was no organized biobank and no agonizing over return of results. There was no pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, so no worries about using in vitro fertilization for sex selection or rescue siblings. And psychologists didn't peer into subjects' brains with real-time MRI scans while asking them questions about their thoughts and feelings. It is not surprising that new activities of this sort challenge our thinking and provoke major change in norms. Thus, what is so very remarkable, I believe, about the changes that occurred in our views and practices regarding foregoing life-sustaining treatment is that the biomedical reality for the choices really hasn't changed radically. Of course, the healthcare system now has means to rescue many patients with physical and neurological injuries that even 30 years ago would have been fatal. And along with the increase in the number of patients, the level of acuity among hospitalized patients has increased. But patient by patient, the issue of whether to forego treatment with its burdens, when its burdens grow too heavy or the desirability of its probable outcomes seems questionable, remains essentially as it was 30 years ago when the President's Commission issued deciding to forego life-sustaining treatment. Yet between the time of that report and today, physicians, patients, and the leaders of healthcare institutions have seriously rethought their answers to the core questions raised by care at life's end. I believe that the Commission and its staff ethicists played a major role in that transformation. But I've laid it out now simply to urge you to reconsider that certain philosophical arguments or insights, however familiar or intuitively correct they may seem to you now, nonetheless played a major role in upending what was then a set of widely held beliefs that resulted in many issues affecting the end-of-life care being dealt with very poorly or not at all. I have no way of unpacking, and I doubt that anyone does, the contribution to that state of affairs that can be laid at the doorstep of physicians' self-interest or indifference or overwork or psychological or emotional hang-ups versus that which can be ascribed to institutional factors. Of one thing, however, I am certain. A good deal of the avoidance of considering whether to forgo life-prolonging medical interventions came from healthcare professionals' impressions of their moral and legal obligations, which boil down to the conviction that acting to end a life is wrong. Thus, the problem came down to the lack of good tools for sorting out which acts actually fall into that taboo category. Just 2 years before the commission was authorized, the New Jersey Supreme Court had made front page news when it held that the parents of Karen Quinlan, a 21-year-old in a persistent vegetative state, could authorize her physicians to turn off the respirator that, some experts thought, was needed to sustain her life, provided that the parents' choice had been approved by a hospital ethics committee, which was at that time non-existent in that or most any other facility. Further, the court held that the physicians could comply with the parents' instructions without being guilty of homicide should the withdrawal of the ventilatory support result in her death, which it didn't. She lived another 9 years sustained by a feeding tube. The Quinlan's request had initially been rebuffed by the hospital on the ground that the terminating life support violated the professional duty to Karen, a conclusion doubtless reinforced by the local district attorneys having announced that he would prosecute them if they had done so. The Superior Court had then declined to overrule the physician's refusal. The New Jersey Supreme Court's decision was regarded as a landmark because it went against what many people thought was the law and was certainly prevailing practice at the time. But the ruling not only left open the question of what law would prevail in other states, but also did not clarify the weight to be given to the various moral distinctions that were then usually invoked in debating whether a patient, or those deciding on behalf of a patient, can refuse care needed to sustain life. The commission, therefore, took as one of its first tasks to explore those distinctions, whose invocation the commission concluded is, quote, often so mechanical that it neither illuminates an actual case nor provides an ethically persuasive argument. In this work, the commission heavily relied upon Professor Brock. So how well does philosophy do in hand-to-hand combat with a taboo? To begin with my conclusion, I would say both well and poorly. The conceptual analysis provided in deciding to forgo life-sustaining treatment had many beneficial effects on the thinking of courts in resolving cases and announcing legal standards, on the practices of healthcare professionals and the opinions of hospital ethics committees, and on academic discourse. Even though the ideas in the report had received previous attention, having them drawn together and examined very clearly, and perhaps most important, having their implications so directly addressed was enormously important for the development both of policy and practice. The Commission's intention was not primarily to help individual professionals, institutional bodies, patients, and families to employ the concepts more adroitly on a case-by-case basis, but rather to free individual decision-making and public policy from the mistaken limitations imposed when slogans and labels are substituted for careful reasoning that is required. The distinctions in question, which were cataloged by the Commission as causing death by acting versus omitting to act, withholding versus withdrawing treatment, the intended versus the unintended but foreseeable consequences of a choice, and ordinary versus extraordinary treatment, were important precisely because they were often trotted out when difficult cases arose or when policies about care at the end of life were being formulated. They point to concerns that are germane to the making of legally and morally acceptable decisions, but as used at the time, they tended to confuse matters or even to lead decision makers astray. For example, the lesson then drawn from withholding and withdrawing, that dichotomy, namely that it would violate the duty of care to cease a treatment once begun, even if not beginning such a treatment in the same patient would be acceptable, or at the very least, that extra justifications would be needed to withdraw the treatment, was wrong and actually harmful to good patient care. The reason for commencing many treatments is to see whether they can improve patients' conditions, yet the then prevailing interpretation of withdrawing versus withholding made some physicians unwilling to begin possibly but not certainly curative interventions out of fear that they would be obligated to continue them indefinitely. Patients were thereby denied trials of therapy that in some cases would actually have achieved the effect desired. Moreover, when a trial does not succeed, the choice not to continue to treat can then be based on evidence rather than guided by mere surmise, as it necessarily is when a physician is trying to decide whether or not to launch a therapeutic attempt in the first place. Given its commitment to patient autonomy and informed consent, it's easy to see why the Commission would go after those moral and legal distinctions that were invoked when physicians declined to honor requests by patients or surrogates to forgo life-sustaining treatment. But the Commission was equally keen to demolish others, such as the distinction between ordinary and extraordinary interventions, and between intended and unintended but foreseen consequences that were typically invoked to justify foregoing life support or acting in a way that could lead to death. Let me turn just to the latter, which was called by Roman Catholics the doctrine of double effect. But it was familiar even to non-Catholics because it was so often cited in medical settings to explain why certain acts, such as the giving of morphine to relieve severe pain in a dying patient, were licit even though they produced a result, in the case of morphine, the suppression of respiratory drive leading to death, that would be forbidden if sought directly. This distinction poses a practical difficulty in application because it depended upon distinguishing the wrongness of two acts based upon the actor's intentions. And we usually gain access to intentions either through an actor's statements, which are usually discounted unless it's a confession of a wrongful intent, or by deducing intention based on an act's consequences, which doesn't work here because the consequences of the two acts, the giving of morphine or let's say the giving of a poison, is ex hypothesis the same, namely the death of the patient. But what if, given that morphine merely risks death rather than causing it in every case, we were willing to credit a physician's insistence that a particular patient's death was merely the foreseen rather than the intended consequences of the physicians having administered the morphine in response to the request from the patient to end his suffering. Should that physician be treated differently as an ethical and legal matter than a colleague who has responded to the same request from another patient by administering strychnine, the lethal potential of which was spelled out and accepted by the patient, and which, by causing the patient's death, did indeed relieve his suffering? Both physicians intended to relieve suffering and accomplish that end, and both patients died. Does the route or timing of the relief of suffering, one coming before the patient died, the other after, provide a legitimate basis for labeling one action morally and legally acceptable and the other a homicide? No. If we are right to differentiate how we treat the two actions, it has to be for other reasons. Yet whatever its analytic faults, the doctrine of double effect was beloved by many physicians and nurses treating patients with severe physical pain because it gave them a framework within which they could fulfill their ancient professional obligation to relieve the patient's suffering without seeming to violate a taboo. Yet the doctrine nevertheless misled healthcare professionals about the moral reasoning process that was actually necessary if their act was to be defensible. Like all actors, they are responsible for all the foreseeable consequences of their actions, not merely those that they intend. Their focus should thus be on whether the circumstances justifying taking a particular risk, such as the risk of shortening life that comes with a particular intervention to relieve suffering, is justified. The danger is that the doctrine might seem to excuse any death that follows the administration of morphine, whereas in each case, justifications must be provided. Was the morphine actually needed, or was there another safer way of relieving pain? Was the dose of morphine correct? And most importantly, did the extremity of the patient's condition warrant risking death? There is a world of difference between relieving pain in a manner that may cause death for a patient with an untreatable and imminently fatal cancer and taking the same risk with a patient suffering from a bad fracture who will soon be healed and pain-free. Thus, the accepted use of morphine does not depend upon the doctrine of double effect, but on the same sort of calculation that would be applied to any decision to undertake a highly risky medical procedure, such as a novel form of surgery. What is the balance of prospective benefits and harms? The moral issue, the commission concluded, is whether or not the decision makers have considered the full range of foreseeable effects, have knowingly accepted whatever risk of death is entailed, and have found the risk to be justified in the light of the paucity and undesirability of other options. As powerful and clear as the Commission's exposition of moral philosophy may have been, many of the changes in professional practice and public policies that occurred in the subsequent decade would certainly have happened anyway. Indeed, the 5 years leading up to the Commission's report, 1978 and 82, had already witnessed a raft of important court cases and statutes establishing the rights of patients and surrogate decision makers to order an end to life support, as well as numerous publications by academics and non-governmental organizations largely affirming these rights. Therefore, the Commission's analysis, greatly guided and enriched by its staff philosophers, did not so much extend the boundaries of the frontier as gather the extant observations and findings to help new settlers by mapping the known terrain, thus providing a clearer picture of where cliffs or swamps made travel dangerous, where the land was safe to occupy, and where and whence originated the rivers that brought comfort and life to the inhabitants. Having such a map, drawn in such a comprehensive and meticulous fashion by such an authoritative cartographer, did much to shape the thinking of physicians and the public, and more particularly to guide judges who cited the report in their decisions, and hospital ethics committees, which not only propagated the report's ethical analysis and practical guidance within their institutions, but also adopted its views about ethics committees' own structure, duties, methods, and institutional and social functions. Yet some aspects of the Commission's work went well beyond organizing and anointing the enlightened ideas already put forward by leading philosophers, lawyers, and physicians. One of the most significant of these areas involves legislation adopted around the country to allow people to specify who should act on their behalf should they become incapable of deciding for themselves. Informal processes of turning to surrogate decision makers in such circumstances have long been a feature of medical care. One could say they amount to public policy because the physician's practice of relying on those who are close to an incapacitated patient to help make treatment decisions is, in effect, a de facto standard, well known and generally accepted. In the wake of the Quinlan case, legislatures around the country rushed to adopt statutes allowing people to set forth legally recognized instructions about the care they wanted and didn't want at the end of life. These statutes were intended to address a major weakness in the living will. When first proposed in the 1960s as a means to lift the burden of decision about life-prolonging care from family members' shoulders by reassuring them that the signatory would not want heroic measures used to extend his or her life, living wills admitted on their face that they lacked the power to bind anyone, whether surrogate or physician. The first post-Quinlan statute, adopted by California in 1976, came in the form of the Natural Death Act, so named to meet the objection of euthanasia opponents that foregoing treatment causes death, one of those shibboleths that the commission later attacked. Instead, the statute suggested a person signing a Natural Death Act directive to a physician was simply asking the physician to step aside and allow death to occur naturally in consequence of the person's underlying medical condition. The commission concluded that statutes of this type had two major deficiencies. First, the laws were narrowly directed towards patients who were about to die, and their terms were often extremely limited and complicated. Second, the Natural Death Acts were instruction directives, meaning that they offered a person the opportunity to specify particular treatments that he or she did not want if diagnosed with a, quote, terminal condition. The notion that particular treatments are desirable or not, which is not unique to the advanced directives field, but arises repeatedly of discussions of limiting medical care when terms are used such as heroic measures or ordinary versus extraordinary means, makes no sense independent of the patient's circumstances. More helpful are appointment directives, or as the commission termed them, proxy directives, under which a person can designate an agent who is able to engage with the treating physician in assessing the person's evolving medical and general condition and decide what care is appropriate in light of the expected consequences of one intervention or another, or none at all. Better still is the joinder of the two forms in which a person appoints an agent, also usually called a surrogate decision maker, with legal authority to make the healthcare decisions and offers advice about the values and goals that should guide the decisions, as well as thoughts about what the agent should do if the person were in certain medical conditions with particular prognoses and specific medical interventions were being offered. Such advice can inform the agent's decision making without rigidly controlling the particular choices made. The central problem with appointing an agent to make end-of-life decisions is that under the common law, all agents lose their power to act when the principal loses the capacity to make decisions. Many states had, at the time the commission was writing, recently overcome the traditional rule that incompetence automatically discharges an agent appointed to manage financial affairs and property by specifying that a power of attorney could be specified to be durable, meaning that it would survive the makers becoming incompetent. The President's Commission developed provisions and procedures needed to safely use these durable powers of attorney in the context of health care rather than property. All states now authorize a person to appoint a health care attorney in fact, proxy, surrogate, representative, or some other term for an agent with the authority to make medical decisions for the person when, or under some statutes, and if chosen by the principal, even before the person loses decision-making capacity. The statutes all limit the range of treatments over which the agent has authority and may require the person to specifically give the agent any powers related to care at the end of life, especially authority to refuse artificial nutrition or hydration, which, for various reasons, is still singled out as different from other forms of medical care. Now, I've told you that the commission, as personified by its staff philosophers, including Dan Brock, did both well and poorly in changing care at the end of life. The changes I've sketched, which include those wrought in the law by legislatures and courts, but also changes in the behavior and beliefs of physicians, nurses, and healthcare facility leaders, are, I believe, extensive and dramatic. And anyone who teaches medical students, as both Dan Brock and I have been doing for decades, has seen an enormous shift in their views on a number of subjects, not the least regarding the acceptability of withdrawing life-sustaining treatment and aiding patients to achieve a good death. Part of the shift in views can be attributed to students' exposure, still somewhat paltry at many institutions, to palliative care techniques. It's much more comfortable for a physician, or a physician in the making, to accede to a patient's refusal of life-extending treatment if there's something else the physician can do. But the changes I'm thinking about aren't limited to those brought on by having an array of hospice-related options to employ in place of the pursuit of all-out cure. Rather, these changes are apparent as soon as the medical students show up for classes, and they're probably apparent to faculty who teach bioethics to undergraduates. Students no longer arrive at medical school assuming that as physicians they will be directing patients from on high, that it will be their responsibility to ensure their patients follow the course they have judged to be in the patient's best interest. Their byword is patient autonomy, not clinical judgment and beneficence. And the mentors who steer them through their introduction to clinical medicine and who 30 years ago would have set straight any student who arrived with such confused thinking now cheer them on. They're instructed in how to break bad news and guide their patients to confront the need to prepare themselves for the dying process with reassurance that their physicians will be there every step of the way. Topics and activities that were once taboo are now part of the curriculum. But a swinging pendulum doesn't come quickly to rest at the center point, as I was reminded by the highly publicized case that may have caught your attention earlier this month. Tim Bowers, a 32-year-old recently married Indianan whose wife was pregnant with their first child, had been hunting deer in the woods when he fell 15 feet to the ground and suffered such a severe injury to his spine that the physicians caring for him concluded that he would probably remain paralyzed from his shoulders down forever and unable to breathe on his own. Based on his prior statements, Bowers' family believed that he would not want to be kept alive on a respirator. They therefore asked the physicians to remove the induced sedation so he could be questioned directly about his wishes. When asked by his sister, an intensive care nurse, "Do you want this?" Mr. Bowers shook his head no. After confirming that Bowers did not want further treatment, the physicians removed the tube connecting him to the ventilator, and he died 5 hours later on the day following the accident. Since Bowers' family and physician apparently all accepted his decision to forgo life support, it is curious that the case came to public attention. After all, such situations arise every day across the country in which competent patients decide to end life-extending treatment. And if neither the family nor the health professionals providing care disagree and take the matter to court, the decision usually remains private. The news media stated that what was unusual about the case was that the decision was made by the patient rather than the family or an appointed surrogate, as had happened in the highly publicized court cases where patients had suffered cognitive rather than solely spinal injuries, such as Quinlan, Cruzan, and more recently, Shivo. What struck many participants in the MCW bioethics listserv when the story was posted there was not the patient's participation in the decision, but its rapidity. Those commentators with experience treating spinal cord paralysis were shocked at how quickly the decision was made. They reported that the attitude of many such patients toward treatment changes over time as they overcome their initial horror at their altered physical selves and rise to the challenge of gaining as much mobility and independence as possible. Other listserv participants greeted this reaction with horror of their own. On what ground could physicians imprison a competent patient and force treatment on him, much less engineer a change in what sort of life the patient wanted to live? Those who favored temporizing were challenged to explain what should happen if in a day or a week Mr. Bowers hadn't changed his decision to forego life support. How long could the hospital continue to hold him in order to try to change his mind? In reply, some pointed out the time was needed not only to let the patient adjust and understand his options more fully, but also to give his physicians time to make sure their prognosis was grounded on reliable evidence and the latest data on recovery following spinal damage. Still, the question remained, where does good medicine end and simple paternalism begin? And was paternalism really the whole story, or might some of those who wanted the patient under these circumstances to change his mind be seeking this not for his benefit, but for their own, be it avoiding being reminded of their own therapeutic limitations or feeling responsible for a death or a challenge to their religious beliefs about the sacredness of life? The physicians and family's response to Mr. Bowers' choice and the various reactions it provoked among bioethicists on the web reveals how much end-of-life ethics has changed over the four decades since physicians forcibly subjected Donald Cowart to painful treatments for 10 months after he was severely burned in an explosion. I doubt that those gathered at Mr. Bowers' bedside formally decided to utilize a rights approach as opposed to some other ethical method for making decisions about his care. Despite the concerns expressed by some of the bioethics commentators, the approach that they did use aligns with the premise assumed by both the majority and the dissenters in the Cruzan decision. A competent patient has a right to refuse any treatment, even if doing so will rapidly lead to the end of his life. But perhaps a rights framework was the method used simply because others, principalism or virtue ethics, for example, would have provided answers that are less crisp and easy to implement. I think the case also reveals that the default position about what to do in the absence of instructions has shifted, or at least is in the process of shifting. In setting forth practical guidance for reaching decisions about persistently unconscious patients and seriously ill newborns, the President's Commission reaffirmed that the default is always to err on the side of preserving life. One conclusion to be drawn from the Bowers case and from the experience with the medical students is that that presumption is no longer in place. The physicians didn't say, "Mr. Bowers, we know that competent patients have a right to decline treatment, but your circumstance is such that there is at least some question whether you have the capacity at this moment to make the decision to do so, or that the evidence we've been able to provide you is adequate to enable you to make it. So until that's been clarified, we're going to keep you alive." If that's the case, does this default change also apply to patients who are clearly unable to express their wishes themselves? Would that not mean that if a now incapacitated patient had failed to make his wishes known through an advance directive, the default would indicate that it would be appropriate to withdraw all treatment? In sum, what practical guidance has philosophy provided, not just to healthcare professionals, but to the general public about how to weigh the competing principles of respect for persons and beneficence? Three decades ago, ethicists helped liberate practitioners from the constraints and confusions created by the then prevailing moral dichotomies, but much of the necessary deeper reasoning seems never to have been as well or as fully conveyed. While the Bowers case reminds us that even when patients are able to participate, decisions about life, foregoing life support can be problematic, the President's Commission was wise to focus on the treatment of patients who are currently unable to take part in decision making, as also has Professor Brock, since that group of patients raised the most difficult issues. I believe that the Commission made a substantial contribution to medicine and public policy by propagating that concept of the durable power of attorney for health care, sometimes called DPAHC, as a means to facilitate ethically grounded treatment choices for that group of patients, as a sort of vaccine against stressful decision-making undertaken by someone not chosen by the patient and without guidance from the patient. In 1990, the federal government gave a boost to advance directives with the Patient Self-Determination Act, which mandates that all hospitals, nursing homes, and health plans inform their patients and subscribers of their rights to make healthcare decisions, including refusing life support, and how the law of their state allows them to execute a directive. Perhaps the hospital admissions clerk is, however, not the person with whom most of us would want to have that conversation. For whatever reasons, the PSDA has not made durable powers of attorney or other advanced directives universal. Almost all Americans know about advanced healthcare directives, and 84% are reported to support laws that allow people to decide to forego life support. Yet despite the increase since the living will was first promulgated in the 1960s, as of 2006, only about 30% of people self-report having an advanced directive. Despite the gradual increase in the percentage of Americans who have a directive, physicians and nurses in intensive care units, a setting full of patients getting life-sustaining treatment who lack decision-making capacity, report that advanced directives are in evidence in only a small fraction of the cases. If any other vaccine, to use my analogy before, actually had an impact on such a small portion of relevant cases, we would regard it as a failure of preventive medicine. The percentage is a good deal higher among patients who actually die, but that is skewed by those who receive care in hospice or in a nursing home and may be affected by bereaved family members in the study that reported that up to 70% have such documents at the time of death, describing as a directive a pulsed form, the physician's orders on life-sustaining treatment, which have been legally authorized in about a dozen states in the past 15 years. And even if everyone had an advance directive, would care be different? In the 1990s, the study to understand prognoses and preferences for outcomes and risks of treatment, called SUPPORT, involving almost 5,000 seriously ill patients at five teaching hospitals, found little effect either from direct intervention that aimed to involve patients or from the advanced directives that were found in the hospital records of 15% of the patients. About two-thirds of the directives were durable powers of attorney, but very few of those followed the Commission's advice and joined specific instructions about life-sustaining treatment to the appointment of the healthcare agent. Worse yet, even when the specific instructions were present, care was potentially inconsistent with those instructions in half of the cases. Furthermore, it takes a lot of careful conversation to make sure that the form that will be there when decisions have to be made about an unconscious patient truly reflect the patient's values and preferences. There is special reason to be concerned about the absence of quality data on pulses. What sort of interaction goes into them, especially when they are completed by the physician responsible for the care of all the residents in a nursing home. And if we are worried about overtreatment, and there are very good reasons why we should continue to be, pulse and other directives may ironically reinforce the problem because their very existence suggests that the default position is treat unless not told to. So we have two potential conflicting default positions here with no clarity. In the end, I am left to conclude that we have reached a limit to what philosophy may be able to provide. We have need now for two radically different things. On the one hand, much more conversation within families, as well as with friends and spiritual advisors, about what people want at the end of life, leading up to realistic conversations with physicians well before the moment of crisis about what medicine can actually provide. Of course, the proposal to compensate physicians for such conversations is the very thing that produced Sarah Palin's charge of death panels. PolitiFact's Lie of the Year for 2009. On the other hand, we need close collaboration between physicians, hospitals, and payers to improve the system of communication and decision-making. Many physicians who don't talk with their patients about advance directives and care at the end of life fail to do so because they don't feel equipped and well-supported for this role. Now, having spoken of end-of-life ethics, I turn now to end-of-life economics. Critics of waste in the healthcare system point to what they term the disproportionate share of healthcare spending that occurs in the last 3 or 6 months of life, or cite data from the Dartmouth Atlas showing that very sick patients who die at the Mayo Clinic cost Medicare roughly $50,000 apiece, while comparable deaths, I'm sorry to say, Bob, at UCLA lead to charges of more than $100,000. Yet many people are quick to respond that such talk is offensive because human life is of infinite value and the implication that we should ration care will disvalue the lives of the very sick and especially the elderly. But as we should have learned from treating end-of-life care as a taboo subject 40 years ago, not talking about something doesn't make it go away. So we need public discussion of cost-effectiveness analysis regarding end-of-life care and the rationing of care generally. Fortunately, Dan Brock's contributions to the ethics of rationing is a subject for another contribution to this festschrift by Daniel Hausman, so I will simply briefly note the intersection of his assignment with mine. The issue of rising healthcare spending, and particularly the prospect that empowering people to refuse life-prolonging treatment and seek lower intensity care at the end of life would help constrain spending, was considered by the President's Commission. The Commission concluded that the improvements in decision-making about life-sustaining treatment that it proposed should be valued for themselves rather than because they were conducive to rationing care. It suggested that maintaining comatose patients for months or years and similar instances of futile treatment may seem like good targets for cost-cutting, but the inappropriate use of ordinary diagnostic and therapeutic means, though less visible or dramatic, actually provide a larger and less controversial target. The little ticket items deserve our attention before the big tickets. Subsequent studies suggest that we were right. Having an advance directive or even a DNR order or being enrolled in a hospice does not result in any significant savings in the cost of care at the end of life. Now, we need more data, and we need a better model of the phenomenon we're trying to study. First, are we looking at the right cohorts? 25 years ago, Ann Sutosky, a member of the commission, and I pointed out the difficulty with using Medicare data on care in the final 6 months of life. Physicians can't tell going in whether it is the patient's last 6 months of life. Slightly more than half of the patients on whom a great deal is spent actually benefit. They survive and leave the hospital, a phenomenon that the Dartmouth Atlas misses, as critics point out, because its data on the high cost of dying concern only patients who don't survive. Second, what are the sources of the pressure to use life-prolonging care when it will only produce marginal benefits or none at all? Does it come from unreasonable expectations of patients and family, the do-everything syndrome? And if so, where do such expectations originate? In religion, in culture, in popular entertainment, or from physicians themselves? And generally, what about the economic, psychological, and professional pressures on physicians as a source of unnecessary prolonging care? 4 decades ago, those pressures and the behaviors they produced in physicians were a focus of the Death with Dignity movement. Is there any reason to think that the advances we have made in ethical decision-making have been such that those pressures have been eliminated? I doubt it, which means that in order to improve the rationality of care, we ought to be addressing that problem, rather than starting by rationing the care we make available to patients with potentially lethal conditions. Finally, I come back to an area where we could use help from our philosophical colleagues. because in bringing patients and families into decision-making about care, in an attempt to overcome what was then the widespread paternalism of physicians, we overshot the mark. We've given patients and family the impression they are the engineers of the train, whereas what we wanted them to know is that they are passengers who are free to get off at any station and to get on another train. But informed consent does not mean getting to decide to take the train off the tracks in search of something that medicine is not equipped to provide. So we are left, in the end, with a set of decisions about end-of-life care, which have been greatly clarified by the work of philosophers such as Dan Brock and the work of the commission that he served. But we are also left with many unsolved problems. And I hope that Dan and his colleagues will continue to help us solve them. Thank you.
Alex, that was a bravura performance and absolutely typical of you. And so I'm for those who may not have had the pleasure of hearing Alex talk in the past, I'm glad that you now have had it. I only saw parts of Alex's talk in advance, and so I'm giving some remarks that are somewhat spontaneous and also sort of come at this at a different angle. But I hope that some of this will be of interest. Some of it is just some reminiscing, but what the hell. First of all, let's go back to the days of this President's Commission. Can I ask for a show of hands, how many people, now being honest, how many people have ever heard of this commission? Ho-ho! Well, you're not a representative sample, are you? My students, you know, they have no idea what the hell I'm talking about, because this was really, apart from an earlier commission that had been created by the federal government for one task only, which was to look at human subjects research, this is the first sort of general purpose bioethics commission, and there have been many since. There's one now, and now it's the tradition that every new president creates his or her own so far. So they all blur, you know. But this is the first one, and it really was a remarkable thing. Now there are these commissions all over the world. There's even a global summit of national bioethics commissions, which Alex and I created. And it meets every 2 years. It will meet this next year in Mexico City. They have no idea of their history either. So how come philosophers got mixed up in this? That's why. Alex was a precocious young law professor at Penn, I think you were, who had, when he was still in knee pants, had published a masterly, co-authored a masterly essay on the definition of death that was regarded as the most significant contribution on this, I think, certainly in the law journals. And on the strength of that and his other achievements, when this new commission was created, Alex was asked, despite his youth and so on, to be the executive director. He accepted that and more or less ran the thing. He had the final word on every report, and in Alex's case, that meant whatever you gave him came out transformed. Now, Alex insisted from the very beginning that the commission should have a post had the title staff philosopher, and somewhere buried in the congressional record is exchange that went on at the moment when the formal commissioner head, who was Morris Abram, went to Congress and went over the budget for this proposed commission, and you know, staff physician fine, staff lawyer fine, staff philosopher. They couldn't make any sense of this, Alex and Morris said, no, we have to have that. Okay, so they created this position. That was really seen as truly weird back then. Now it's a little bit more common. In addition to having a post of staff philosopher, which was filled by Dan and me and Alan Buchanan, who is also here in 1 year each, Alex also said to me when I was there, here's some money, put together a philosophy advisory board. And I'll just want to mention to those of you who know something about philosophy and the people in it, who was on that board. So it consisted of Dan Brock, who was not yet staff philosopher, Alan Buchanan, who was not yet staff philosopher, but also Norman Daniels, and David Gautier, a renowned political philosopher, Alan Gibbard, one of the finest moral philosophers, and Sidney Morganmesser, just resident genius. And we had periodic meetings, and the level of discussion was just very, very satisfying. Now, back then, I told you I'd reminisce a little bit. This idea of being in a public public service and working in a commission-like environment was something new to all of us philosophers who did it. We were used to academia, and in academia, you seek the very highest level that you can, and the whole idea is to weed out every thought that isn't absolutely precise. But of course, in this environment, that would be a recipe for disaster. First of all, no one could understand what you're talking about. But it was, you had to deal with the fact that the subject matter here was somewhat philosophical, or that was our job, was to show how it could be somewhat philosophical, but it was also inevitably mixed up with the messy details of public policy. So frankly, it felt like slumming. And all of us were unsure of what were we doing here, and were we abandoning our professional standards by even being here and participating in these messy debates with non-philosophers. You know, it sounds really ridiculous now, but that's what we were thinking. And we talked about it a lot. Now, looking back, that was really a golden age. The level of philosophizing at the commission, I think it's fair to say, really was remarkable in retrospect. And just the people who were invited to give testimony, Philip Afoot showed up and gave marvelously enlightening testimony on decisions to forgo life-sustaining therapy and the like. So slumming wasn't the word. I mean, this was something to aspire to. I wish that that standard had been upheld. But Alex, I have to say, gets a lot of the credit. And Dan, I think, showed in the work that he contributed to, especially to this report on deciding to forgo therapy, what value could come out of having a really good philosopher work on this. Now, it really helped that you know, people like Dan were recruited from academia. Dan was already an intellectual leader in this field. And he moved right into the job and didn't have to learn anything. He was there to teach. And he set about dismantling these crutches and taboos that have been used for so long in clinical medicine, little homilies and mottos and so on that had been used as, that were nothing better than rules of thumb, but they've been elevated to the status of eternal truths. And by dismantling them and showing that they didn't deserve the status of eternal truth, and that there were some serious problems of logic when they were deployed, the picture one had of what the dilemma was facing doctors and patients really was transformed. And I agree with Alex, it's very hard to know what the actual specific effects of that report have been over these years, because a lot of other things are changing. But there has been a remarkable change in the way these things are talked about. And these old homilies are no longer given automatic respect in the wards, and also in academia, and legal writing, and in judicial decisions, and so on. It's hard to avoid the thought that Dan's masterly analysis that was put into that report wasn't a major factor. Now, the situation with regard to the introduction of philosophers and philosophy into public policy bodies like the President's Commission, especially in healthcare, has been transformed. And it's not just that we've gotten used to it and that the public has gotten used to us. It's that the whole status of ethics as something fit for rational discussion has been transformed. And I think there are many sources for that. But what we find now is that people in other fields also think it's worthwhile talking about ethics, and they actually do it. So at conferences that we hold here, we mix it up with economists and decision theorists and law professors. And everybody takes the ethical questions as something that's fit for analysis and that we might make progress on if we really, really think hard, and it is hard. That's not the way it used to be. Tim Scanlon tells a story about one of the first conferences that actually invited philosophers to show up along with people in public policy. And what he found was that when an ethical question came up, the economists and some others would say, but that's a value judgment, meaning don't waste time talking about that. That's the way it was. Value judgment meant, you know, it's a matter of feeling or, you know, what, how you're toilet trained or something or other, but, you know, don't pretend that you can say something about it that would illuminate anything, because all you'd be doing is, you know, sharing your feelings. But now it's an academic staple. And I'll come back to this at the very end. So things are really totally different. So what is the value then of having all this stuff done? Well, sometimes it's valuable and sometimes it's absolutely not. And we saw that at the commission. The report on forgoing therapy, deciding to forego therapy, I think has to be counted as one of the great successes. And it was a success because the philosophy in it was so good, and it, at least in large part, so good and so lucid, thanks to Dan Brock. Now, there were other reports in which the role of philosophy was not so good. There was a paper written by Alan Weisbart, who was the legal director, after he had left the commission, about a particularly unfortunate episode. He thought it was unfortunate because he was talking about the project he had devoted about a year to. It was an extremely elaborate system for compensating people who were injured in health research. Ultimately, although it was a beautiful thing, it should have been enacted then, the commission refused to accept it. And he thought the reason it sank was because of the asinine and idiotic intervention by the staff philosopher, in offering his philosophical insights, provided a line that the opponents of this thing rode to victory and killed the whole thing prematurely. That philosopher is speaking to you right now, actually. So that one didn't work out so well. Now, in other cases, for example, in the definition of death report, I think we have to say it's mixed. Now, I'm going to share a secret with you, not a secret to Alex. This was the report that basically explained to the American public why we should change our definition of death so that people who are brain dead should be considered dead. And that turned out to be a very important step toward making organ transplantation routine and unproblematic, and also help with questions about ceasing care for some patients. Now, there was a difference of opinion on the staff about brain death, the status of brain death as death, and also on the reasoning that applied. Alex was a believer. He had published this early article championing this, despite the fact that I had already published an article casting doubt on the whole thing. Alex hired me as the staff philosopher, and I didn't change my mind when I got there, not one whit. So we really went at it for some time. And what I came to believe, and you know, I'm making myself vulnerable here, especially to Francis, what I came to believe was that I should sort of muffle some of my reservations. Because I came to think that the country, the world would be much better off if it accepted brain death as death, despite the fact that I thought the arguments in favor of it didn't make any sense. I thought that then, I think it now. So it was my job to write the crucial chapter that it's called The Meaning of Brain Death. It was the one that gave the rationale for including brain dead patients as in the category of dead people. And I mentioned some of my reservations, but I soft-pedaled them and I said, you know, who knows, matter of opinion, blah, 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 blah. I didn't think so, but. Now, if I'd written it the other way, Alex would have changed it because he had the last word here and he believed it. But actually, I concurred in the end. I thought, yes, this is the right thing to do. So it has, the thing has a kind of fudge in it. And for a while, I think it really did serve the country well in the ways that I said. But you know, that zombie, it's gotten up from that grave and it's coming stalking us now. Recently, there was an article by Bob Trug in New England Journal, some of you may have seen. And, you know, it's pointing to this zombie. And I think Norm Faust, as you'll hear later, shares that view also. I'm working on a paper having to do with China's decision to stop using prisoners as sources of, executed prisoners as sources of organs. And damned if this zombie isn't haunting that thing too, because they're following WHO advice, which, by the way, we can thank Alex for. He's the been the chief guide of all this stuff. China's being urged to use cadaver organs. And that raises the question of, you know, what's a cadaver? And are brain dead people cadavers? And what are we supposed to tell the Chinese about that? So it just will not stay dead. So you just never know. Now, there was another taboo. There were also these taboos that the commission faced, where we were sort of under orders, don't mess with this. We you know, Dan dismantled those taboos about foregoing treatment. But in the area of rationing in particular, now this is my understanding, Alex can correct me. My perception was the word came down that your multi-volume report on access to care in America is not going to include the word rationing, and it's not going to include the word entitlement. Beyond that, say whatever you want. Well, of course, that's what it was about. It was about rationing and entitlement, so we had a little problem. Basically, we solved it using a thesaurus. And we came up, instead of rationing, we talked about allocation. And instead of entitlement, we talked about government obligation. And then everyone's fine, you know, as long as those words are not in the index so that somebody could find it. But as Alex says, these taboos remain. Now, having the taboo is really a bad thing, because we still can't talk about this. And what it means is that if you begin to broach the question of how should we think rationally about the fact that there are limits, which of course there are, you'll get attacked by this death squad demagoguery, and you can't fight back, because you know you have to pretend that you uphold the taboo. We just haven't, in all these years, we haven't figured out how to deal with this. Now, brief aside, let me mention, this isn't just a factor about American politics. A similar thing happens in global health. It's a battle that I've been a part of. If you start out saying, look, especially in the poor countries where there's just hardly any money for anything, it's especially important to set priorities and figure out, you know, what to do first if you can't do everything. You will be attacked. I've been attacked. Many of us have been attacked by advocates who say, let's not talk about that. Let's talk about how to get more money so you don't have to make those choices. And I respect the people who say that, and especially because they have gotten more money, and you know, so you didn't have to make the choices. So they've got a point too. But it's hard to do any work on that stuff without being attacked, sort of blindsided by that complaint. Paul Farmer, who is, you know, a hero to almost all of us, said at one point, he said, look, these philosophers who start talking about priority setting, what they're doing is they're giving excuses to donors not to increase the size of their donation, because you can tell them how to use their money, the limited funds, most effectively. And they're saying, well, we've done that, and now we'll walk away from the table. And probably that does happen. But at the same time, how can you avoid that, you know, that question when there's so little funds and the needs are so enormous? So we haven't learned how to talk about limits there either, at least not in a way that everybody can accept as a reasonable thing to do that doesn't involve a whole lot of what I've been talking about. Now, one thing that complicates this attempt to talk rationally and reasonably and lucidly about rationing in the United States, in my opinion, is that you can't just do this as if it were a philosophical problem in a textbook, you know, as a purely theoretical exercise, although those exercises are fascinating and many of us indulge ourselves in working on them, because of the fact that the United States' cost structure is so completely out of whack and out of sync with the rest of the world. As everybody in the room knows, we spend about double what some peer countries spend, and their people are healthier than ours. So there seems to be no justification for it. If we don't put that up front and center in any discussion about limits and rationing and, you know, trade-offs, I think the discussion's worthless. There's an old joke. Some of you are old enough to remember the now famous Oregon Medicaid rationing project of some decades ago, where the then governor, who just recently was a reelected governor, Kisshaber, I got the bright idea that instead of having a Medicaid program that segmented the poor into deserving and non-deserving and then gave a nice big fat package to the deserving and ignored everybody else, let's just use the Medicaid dollars to cover all the poor, but we'll provide them with a selective list of services, namely the most important ones. And so he set up a public commission to try to come up with a system for deciding which services would be in that package and which things would be left out. Now, one skeptic, I wish I could remember who it was so I could credit him, said, look, if you think, what is the question that the Oregon Medicaid Rationing Project was supposed to be the answer to? The question was, how can we get important health services to all the poor without reducing the income of doctors by one penny? Well, it's a good question, right? And so when we feel like we maintain the taboo against talking about rationing in America, you know, one day too long, we're not going to stand it anymore. We have to take into account the fact that when we talk about these costs and the unbearability of the costs and the limitations and so on, we're spending twice as much as we should, and the subject would be totally different. The discussion would be transformed if we were talking about stuff that cost half as much. So what to do? Don't know. But I think actually this gives us a little bit of a tip about how to think of the funny mixture of pure philosophy in the academic sense and this messy political stuff. Now, Francis Kam has published a Lucid article that answers a seminal paper that Dan Brock wrote called Truth or Consequences, based on Dan's experience at the commission. This difficult choice that philosophers have when they're brought in because they're philosophers, but now they're part of a team that's not part of a philosophy team. It's a team to improve public policy. And it's very hard to avoid feeling that, look, stop being such a purist. You know, get with the program and let's all come up with something that'll be useful, even if that means bending, you know, the philosophy a little bit. I did it. Dan did it. You know, maybe Frances wouldn't have done it, but she wouldn't have been hired then, right? So, you know, if you're there for a reason. So get with it. So it's a real dilemma. So what to do? You have to be a pure philosopher and ignore the context of, you know, the fact that costs are twice as high as they should be. I think it means that your work is basically worthless and maybe even harmful. So, okay, you can stick to your last and be a philosopher, but it has to be informed by understanding what the realities are. So some mixture there. So let me just conclude. It's been a long time since the idea of having a philosopher advising a government body or even being a member of a team that sort of prescribed government policy would be shocking. It was unheard of in the Congress back when Alex was insisting on it. These days, it's not shocking at all. And as I mentioned, colleagues in many fields have joined us now, and we're all part of a thriving conversation. And I think a lot of the credit for that goes to our honoree, Dan Brock. Not so much because he wrote a textbook on how to do it. It's because he provided a model of how to do it. Dan's stuff really stands up. If you go back and read his articles from that time all the way to the present, what you find is that invariably, before Dan started opining about what to do, he really steeped himself in the literature about, you know, what is and what could be. That was true for the medical realities of deciding to forgo therapy, and it's true now in his most recent work in cost-effectiveness analysis, which has proven to be a rich source of insights for not only philosophers, but economists and health policy people generally who work on this stuff. And it's part of the standard curriculum when cost-effectiveness analysis is taught. So I guess what we should do in the future is just follow Dan's example if we can. Thank you.
All right. Thanks so much to you both. We've got we'll take about 5 minutes or so for comments or questions. Dan?
Mine's very quick because I have a chance at the end of today to make substantive comments, but I think you can say that how fortunate academics don't think of themselves as having bosses.
but how fortunate I was to have Alex as my first boss. Maybe my last, but thank you, Alex. And how fortunate I was, not just because he plumps me up the way he did, but to have Dan as my best friend. So thank you both.
All right. Other comments, questions, please? Yes, come up, use the microphone, please.
Hi, I've studied both philosophy and computer science, so I have a perspective on both. On the computer science, right now people are looking at ICU data, and we may actually be able, with like 99.9%, predict who's gonna die. I hate to say that, but it's true. And that, I mean, so there, it's a moving target. It's definitely a moving target. When I think on the philosophy side, when I think of that man with his broken back, I think, well, what if he had done that in Michigan and his family had to come and there was time and the doctors would have to look? They would just look. I mean, they probably would. And what if his wife had been in labor that minute, you know, just by, you know, bad luck, she just goes early, and now, you know, and what would he have thought then? So did they, you know, clearly they did not. Philosophy still has a role, thank God, for people who like philosophy like me, because clearly they didn't think out all these things, and I don't blame them, I'm just saying. And now, what if he could have had a life with Skype, where he could talk to his boys or whatever he was getting every day, easily? I mean, I don't, you know, it just, they didn't go through the whole rigmarole, and everything's a moving target because of technology and changes in medicine and changes in communication. So I hope philosophy remains strong. Thank you.
All right.
It's more a comment than...
Well, it is a comment, but I think my reason for raising the case was to ask those questions and then at the end to ask, what data do we have relevant to those kinds of choices about saying this care doesn't make sense in this circumstance? Although I suggested that it appears still to be true that the kinds of mechanisms that were invented, the durable power of attorneys and the DNR orders, which back then were a very shocking thing. The idea that you would not use a technology to keep someone alive is very shocking. Although they don't yet seem to differentiate high versus low spending on people, there's got to be a point where they will, as you say, as we have better data about individuals and begin to sort within them. And then the question is, are we willing to use those data to draw a policy? And I'm with Dan Wikler in thinking we will benefit from having philosophers involved in that process and helping us to understand the ethics that's buried in the economics. But we've also got to address somehow the public concern that this is a new form of discrimination and it's arbitrary and it's the government making choices about whose life is worth saving and so forth. So it's actually harder than what we did in knocking down those shibboleths, but it is something I think we can do, but haven't begun to do well yet.
Well, I just think the patients have to be much more educated, because none of us want to lie in a bed for 20 years where we can't think and our families worry about us. None of us wants that. Well, and people don't realize they don't want that till too late.
Right, right.
Could I, we'll do Dr. Farmer and then Dr. Cam? Yeah, professor, okay. Other way around?
Non-sexist gesture.
I have two questions. I'll try to make them brief. One is, why don't lawyers get involved? That is to say, when you say doctors do not listen very often to the requests of the proxies or the patients, that's happened with organ transplantation as well. You have an organ donor card that says you want, and your family comes and says, we don't want you to have, you know, take out the organs, and the doctor listens to the family. Lawyers have now gotten involved there to, and there's a rule that the donor, you know, shall have the last say. And I would like to know why lawyers don't get involved and push doctors around a bit more with respect to the rights that patients are supposed to be having with respect to end of care treatment. The other thing is, I understand the problem of creating philosophy that is acceptable to the public and public decision making, but If you actually look at government reports, I have looked at several of them, not intensively at the death and dying one, but at the one on the use of human embryos and human stem cells. What's his name at Princeton was the head of that commission at the time.
Harold Shapiro was the chair.
Right, right. It's pretty bad. It's really awful. I'm sorry. I mean, I've told. In my opinion, others may disagree. Okay. The one on organ transplantation, which got me started on the rationing thing, it's also not very good. So, the one on organ transplantation, there was a government report, and it was one of my first papers discussing that. I think that philosophers should look at the results of these commission reports, understand that people were under pressure to produce something that was acceptable to a lot of people, but not therefore okay them and pass them, but maintain a critical eye because things can improve and things can, as a result of outside commentary. So I think that we should not turn a blind eye to the mistakes in these reports.
Well, I must say that I think, to go to your first point, physicians feel much more beaten up by lawyers taking them into court than they do by philosophers. So, in fact, I mean, most of the rights that we're talking about are recognized in part because of the famous cases in which lawyers took them. If you ask people who run organ transplant organizations and transplant facilities why they don't listen to the instructions of a person who's filled out an organ donor card, they will say it's just because there are two risks. One, the family will yell and scream saying he revoked. And how do you prove that on the spot? You know, yesterday he told us he doesn't want the card anymore. Until everybody is using a registry, we now have a registry, and in a lot of states, people are signing up on the registries. Until that happens, there's always that issue. But the second one is they just don't want the bad publicity. I don't think, I mean, lawyers tell them, as you say, the law was changed, the Uniform Anatomical Gift Act was changed about 10, 12 years ago to make it very explicit that that is the binding choice and no one else can, and they still disregard it. And I don't think that suing those centers is going to make people want to be organ donors more. People want to have the sense that their interests will be watched out by their family. And if the family feels something is not right there, they want to know that they'll be protected. On your other issue, all of us who've been on these commissions certainly feel we've heard from philosophers about our failings. I'm happy to have you encourage your philosophy students to take commission reports and use them as fodder for articles. I think that's fine, and there's a lot to critique, certainly. There's a lot to critique about a lot of writing of all sorts, and commission reports are certainly more so to the extent that they come out of a somewhat political process. I want to just set the record straight at this level. The report to which Dan referred about access to health care was written in response to one of the congressional charges. The choice was not handed down by anybody other than the commissioners when they were still the original set of Carter commissioners. And the commissioners themselves made the political judgment. There was no dictate from the Congress or from the president. And since we continued through 2.5 years of the Reagan presidency, the notion that that dictate would be coming there is understandable. But there was no dictate. What they made the choice was, if they talked about there being a right to health care and they were going to ground everything on that, when the Supreme Court had said there is no such thing as a constitutional right, which is how we define our rights, the notion of a free-floating human right to health care wasn't going to carry anything, they would write a report that would be instantly dismissed. But if they said that a just society has an obligation to ensure that everyone has equitable access to an adequate level of health care without imposing undue burdens on anyone in that process, they would have something around which people could gather to push for that end. Now, in the end, when you write the statute, giving someone particular access. At that point, they have a statutory right. You can't be denied Medicare, Medicaid, or a lot of other benefits if you have private insurance because you have statutory protections. And then it makes perfectly good sense to talk about it right there. I went to a meeting about 3 months after the commission's report came out, and for the first time met Uwe Reinhardt, who of course has been enormously critical for years of the American healthcare system. And he said, weren't you involved in that commission? He said, that was the most revolutionary report on healthcare I have seen since Harry Truman or whatever. I mean, it was, and it didn't produce Clinton's care and it didn't produce Obamacare and so forth right away. But the people involved in that process even today say that they can ground what they're doing on that report. And so the political choice that the commission made as to its own effectiveness, there was no UCAS from on high about this, was to say, let's talk about the obligation and leave the impression of whether or not we're talking about a right for people to conclude later once it gets put into law. So that was a political choice. You may say it's ridiculous. How can you talk about an obligation unless you're going to assert a right? But the commission managed to do that without falling into that hole.
So Dr. Farmer, would you like to have the last comment before we take a break?
Yes, and I'd like to thank you both for a very stimulating discussion and worthy of Dan, and looking forward to the session on HIV as well. Minor correction, Dan. There's so many Dans in the room that I have to point out which one.
Dan, if you do.
My comment about rationing or about priority setting was not about what the likely behavior of bureaucrats would be, although had I said that, I would have been correct. It was really about the erasure of history and political economy, because, you know, as an example, you could easily make the argument from Haiti in any case that, you know, it was a global political economy, and the movement of commodities in that global political economy, such as ARVs, was worthy of transnational scrutiny. That was the point. In fact, the medication, the arguments made sometimes by philosophers, but there aren't so many philosophers in the world, so usually economists, was that it was possible to identify both the cost and effectiveness of certain interventions, such as the cost of ARVs or the effectiveness of any. I mean, you could go on with, I mean, hepatitis C is going to be the obvious case before us now. Now we have a cure. You're told it's $60,000 per patient per cure. Really? I mean, that was the logic and the math being done around treating AIDS was that it was $10,000 or $15,000 per patient per year, which was a complete social fiction. And, you know, that's why it cost $60 per patient per year 10 years later. And I think the idea, the critique of any kind of ethics that isn't, just, you made that critique yourself just a minute ago, that isn't rooted in understanding of social context, which, you know, history, political economy are part of that. The zombie example, which I loved, Dan, is a good one, because zombie is actually a Haitian word, and it comes from the plantation economies that not only occurred in the Caribbean, but in Brazil, Cuba, and the southern United States, they all have zombie, you know, myths. It happens to be a Haitian word, but it's spread because it's spread along the lines of that political economy. And, you know, it's a good idea. So here's my question, if we have time. Given that it is being revealed more and more, especially in American healthcare, that costs are, especially prices, are social constructions, that in one city, you can have the same procedure costing either $50,000 or $100,000 or $5,000. How do you think we're doing in medical ethics and in these discussions about understanding the social construction of cost and effectiveness?
You know, Paul, I'm sure we have exactly the same view. I think it's rotten. I can't count the number of times that I've been party to a discussion in an academic forum or a policy forum about the need for rationing or about allocation questions in which this cost thing is never mentioned. And yet, it's absolutely essential. So, you know, when I'm in Europe and there's a discussion about, you know, the same thing, someone from the UK will stand up and say, you know, we can't afford to spend another penny on, you know, the healthcare costs are killing us. And what I'm thinking is, look, for every penny you spend, we're spending 2 pennies. You know, the U.S. government spends more per individual. U.S. government spends more per individual than the U.K. spends. But then we ask individuals to match that with, you know, the equal funds from out of pocket. So something is insane here. And so the British are saying that they can't afford another penny, but, you know, we spend twice as much. So why can't they afford a little bit more to get rid of, you know, the shortages they have? And in our case, how can we ask anybody to put up with a deprivation from anything when our costs are absurd and, as you say, are social construction? So, of course, that has to be Exhibit A. So I hope I'm not trying to argue both sides of the argument here, but I absolutely agree that if we don't have a politically informed framework in which to choose the questions to debate, it's worthless. That's not to say that philosophers are good at politics, but we have to at least learn enough about this stuff so that we can intelligently choose the topics that we address. But then, you know, I do think there's room for discussion about priorities and so on, and that, well, you probably agree, but I did take that line from one of your works, of course, but I probably took it out of context.
All right, thank you. I think we've had a terrific first session. I'm already failing in my job as timekeeper here. But we do have a little bit of buffer around lunchtime, so don't panic, or at least tell myself not to panic. Why don't we take about a 10-minute break here, and we'll come back for our next session.